My name is Carrie Ferguson, and I am the State Coordinator for Students Against Destructive Decisions here in Colorado. Welcome. Thank you for tuning in for this presentation of graduated driver license laws here in Colorado. We also have a version given in Spanish, and we hope that you'll find that helpful as well. At this time, I would like to present Michaela Curtis of Mountain Youth in Edwards, Colorado, to give an overview of tonight's presentation, as well as some background on GDL laws. The educational portion of tonight's event will last about 45 minutes, followed by a final Q&A. Michaela, take it away.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us. We will be covering the graduated driver's licensing laws in Colorado and talk about young driver safety and why we're here and ways that you can work as a family and keep our roadways safe. So why are we here? So car crashes, unfortunately, are one of the leading causes of death and injury for young adults. So we are here to help explain what those laws are in Colorado that have been enacted to help keep young drivers safe as they're learning to drive and as they get comfortable on the roadways. And then looking at what are some of those ways that we can be role models and work in the community to create awareness and support youth as they are driving. Or as if you're a young driver, as you're driving. So some of the topics that we'll be going through are the risks of teen driving, what the graduated driver's licensing or GDL laws are in Colorado, tips on parents and youth working together to learn to drive, what some of the resources are that are available in our state or in our communities. And then we will talk about insuring a teen driver. And we have different presenters that will be covering those different areas. So some of the behaviors that we are looking for all drivers to avoid, and particularly for our young drivers, and that's making sure that everybody's wearing a seatbelt and that everybody in the vehicle is buckling up. For those that are under 18, it is a primary ticket. And so it is something that is really important for everybody as they're driving, but especially for young drivers and passengers, that everybody is wearing a seatbelt. Also to remember that there's zero tolerance for alcohol or drug use. And so making sure that as a driver, you are sober and alert and aware and that you don't have any substances that will cause impairment. Keeping the road safe through sober and alert driving. Also about distractions and inattentiveness. So thinking about what are those distractions as you're driving. It could be technology, it could be passengers, it could be other things that are happening on the roadway. And so minimizing distractions in the vehicle and then being alert to what's happening around you. As well as some behaviors to avoid are speeding and peer pressure. So as any driver, we can feel a pressure to want to partake in risky driving behavior or speeding. And so thinking about how to be a cautious driver and especially in school zones or other places in our community, making sure we're driving the speed limit and that we're being safe drivers. With fatigue and drowsy driving, really being aware of how alert you are and how tired you are, and if needing to pull over, take a break, that you are doing those things so that you're not driving drowsy. And then nighttime driving has a lot of other risks associated with lights, with roadside activity, with wildlife, pedestrians, people walking. And so making sure that you're extra alert as you drive at nighttime. And then why Colorado has graduated driver's licensing laws. So when they were enacted and strengthened in 2004, we did see a reduction of young drivers 20 years and younger involved in fatal crashes. And so for us, it's very important that GDL is practiced and followed as it keeps youth safe on the road and prevents unnecessary fatal crashes. And then in 2009, there was a cell phone ban enacted that's continued to strengthen that. And then you'll see a slight increase in that as more drivers are on the road, as our population increases in the state, and as technology has become more ingrained in our daily habits. And so furthering our education around how to practice safe driving, especially around those distractions, is really important. Awesome. We're going to move into teaching your young driver. I'm going to hand it over to Carrie.
Hey, me again. I just want to interject very quickly. You were talking about fatalities, and I wanted to say that in a press release from CDOT, preliminary reports show that over this past Labor Day weekend, there were no traffic fatalities in the state of Colorado. This is preliminary, obviously, but that's huge. So way to go, Colorado. All right, teaching your young driver. How many of you are parents out there? Anybody? I have three, and one of them is you know, still in the beginning stages, and I know it's very nerve-wracking teaching your student to drive. So here we go. When do you start teaching your child to drive? Well, really, they start learning to drive as soon as they turn around in that car seat. So between a year and 2 years, your child is starting to learn to drive based on your behavior. So mimicking what they see should inspire all of us to be better role models, shouldn't it? Be a good role model. Drive how you want them to drive. Begin with optimal conditions. Go when the weather is nice. Start in an empty parking lot. I know parking is a huge thing that you want to practice before your young driver goes out to Walmart for the first time, or to a baseball game or a football game or whatever, where it's going to be crowded. Practice on those neighborhood streets slowly, or take them out to the country where they can drive without a lot of other cars on the roads. Keeping it outside of rush hours, great idea. Be calm and patient. We make mistakes, and that's why it's a great idea to be someplace where they have room to make a mistake without involving somebody else. Give them clear, calm instructions on what needs to happen. And sometimes that's difficult. Take those breaths. Again, get someplace where they are able to make those mistakes. They have room. And then stay focused and ask them to stay focused as well. Remember, your young person is learning, and of course, you're learning to be a teacher of driver's ed at the same time. So give yourselves both a little bit of grace, or a lot of grace. Some tips from CDOT for parents. The more you and your team communicate about responsibilities that come with driving, the more prepared you're both going to be. There's a link down here, and if we can put it in the chat, that would be great. And we'll send these links to you after the presentation as well. But some good tips and tricks for parents and new drivers. Drive at Home is a great program to support support parents. It's developed by the National Safety Council, and it's designed to help parents of newly licensed young drivers by offering free resources that you can use to help your teen build experience and become safer drivers. These are weekly lessons that you can have delivered to your email address. So again, another link, you may sign up to have those done there. Also, Ford Driving Skills for Life has great resources as well, and you can access them on your social media, Facebook, things like that. Just look up Driving Skills for Life, and you can access any of their talks that they do. They do like a drive at five, Wednesday drive at five, and things like that that you can listen to. So good tips for parents. The Colorado Driver Handbook, if you are teaching your young person to drive, or if your student is getting ready to learn to drive, they probably have one of these. You can pick one up in your local DMV building, and it's great for you to look at as well as your young person. You can also download it from this website. Part two, FAQs for the handbook. One thing that SAD and other organizations offer are contracts, parent-teen contracts. Now, this isn't going to prevent your teen from making those mistakes or not calling you when they should to get a ride, but it does open a dialogue between parent and young person about what they can count on from a parent. And it's really important that they be able to count on you for a safe ride home should they feel they need it. Or if they're not sure if they need it, they should feel comfortable to call us. So having these contracts, even though they're not a foolproof guarantee,
for making that good decision. They do open that dialogue, and you know, it doesn't get them out of trouble if they have themselves have been, you know, engaging in an activity that is illegal or they shouldn't and isn't safe. But it gives them the opportunity to call a parent or a trusted adult and make a good decision about getting themselves home safely. And maybe it puts off consequences for a night, as long as they get home safe. And at this time, I would like to pass things on to Grace Meinberg to tell us about the permit process.
Awesome. Thank you, Carrie. So getting started with a permit. So we have GDL to help prevent young fatalities and accidents. GDL consists of some restrictions in order to help with that. So that permit also means that you won't have your cell phone, which means you're not manipulating it in any way, shape, or form. You're not scrolling to the next song. You're not, or skipping to the next song. You're not texting, GPS, et cetera. No phone usage unless it's an emergency only. Also, you have restrictions with the number of passengers. So when you have your permit and you hold that for a year, you can have your parent or guardian, the one who signed the liability affidavit, and some siblings or immediate family. Once that time is over, you are then moving on to your restricted license. We'll get into that. So the number of passengers will change. But at the beginning, it's just that adult over 21 and potential siblings or close family members. That also means these are people you care about, wear your seatbelts. That is a requirement for anyone who is in the vehicle. And then the curfew, state curfew is from 12 a.m. to 5 a.m. That can change by your municipality. So it's always good to just check in and see what your town's curfew time is. But the state curfew, again, is 12 a.m. to 5 a.m. And so when getting your permit, you can start this at different ages. You can start getting it at the age 15. And at 15, you must complete a DMV-approved 30-hour driver education course within the first 6 months. After that 6 months, you can still take that 30-hour, or you can complete a DMV-approved 4-hour driver awareness program. And then once you turn 16, there's no education required. All people under 18 are required to log a minimum of 50 hours behind the wheel with at least 10 hours at night. And one important thing to remember with that is that the only person that can sign those hours, those logged hours for you, is the parent or guardian who signed your liability affidavit. So they there can be multiple names, but that's who gets to sign off on that. And so we do have a resource from the Department of Revenue online that, again, could probably be sent out to you with all the other links. But this is just the one-stop shop to figuring out where you're starting at. So if you or your young driver in your household is turning 15, you go ahead and click on the 15 and see exactly which steps you and your young driver need to take. And it goes all the way through 21 because you need to hold your permit. All youth under 21 need to hold a permit or apply for a permit. And so continuing resources, this is just the same thing, but more visual. So if you're a visual learner, same information, just kind of in a different way for you. So when you go to the DMV and apply for your permit, you're going to need your essential documentation. So this can be your social security card. It can be a passport. You need a parent or a legal guardian that can sign that affidavit of liability. And you also need proof of a current physical Colorado address. And we do have some application fees that go along with that process as well. So once you have your permit, again, there's these restrictions, no cell phone use whatsoever. So no talking on the phone, no texting, no surfing the web, truly no manipulating or having your phone in your hand. The best place to put it is the glove box. So just keep it out of sight, out of mind. Everyone in the vehicle, again, must wear a seatbelt. And then that liable adult that will be driving with you or accompanying you and teaching you while you drive should also be sober and over the age of 21 and must be in the front passenger seat. And only the parent or guardian who signed it can sign off the official driving log. And so the permit that you have obtained must be held for 12 months. For minors under 16 and a half, must additionally complete the 6 hours of behind the wheel, the 12 hours of behind the wheel training with a parent or guardian, and must pass the driving skills road test.
It's Carrie again. All right. So thank you, Grace. Of course, the graduated driver licensing, you know, the graduated, this means that we're students or young drivers are assuming a little bit more responsibility as they continue to improve and get more experience and practice. So the next phase of this process is the restricted license. Of course, driving is a privilege. Cars are tools, not toys. I'm sure our insurance expert Heidi will be talking a little bit about car choices as we get going. Obviously, we don't always have choices in the cars that we choose for our students to start driving in, or limited choices, but she'll give us some good ideas. Obviously, seatbelts mandatory. By law, all teen drivers and passengers must wear seatbelts. No sharing of seatbelts. It's kind of difficult in cars these days, but you never know. We think of all kinds of crafty things when we're young and when we're older as well. No more people in the vehicle than there are seatbelts. Huge, huge thing to enforce in your young driver. No one in the back end of a pickup truck. And everyone needs to be in a seat restraint. Obviously, zero tolerance for impaired driving. The legal limit does not apply to drivers under 21. There is no legal limit because they're not allowed to drink. So zero tolerance, zero drinking and driving. Eight young people die every day in the US in alcohol-related crashes. So something definitely to talk to your young driver about. Also, prescription medicines can cause impairment. So make sure that if your young driver is taking something, either for a medical condition, an existing or chronic condition, or if they've been ill, it's really important that you know what is safe to operate a vehicle on. All right. When you have your restricted license, obviously no passengers are allowed under the age of 21 for the first 6 months. Obviously, immediate family and siblings are exempt. If you have the option though, I mean, something somebody told me was, do you want your kids practicing on your other kids? I did let my kids practice on my other kids with my other kids in the car, but thinking about it that way, well, it's up to us to use our best judgment, right? One passenger allowed under the age of 21 after the first 6 months to a year. So first 6 months, nobody but immediate family in the car who is under the age of 21. After those first 6 months through the first year, one passenger is allowed under the age of 21. Nighttime driving restrictions prohibit driving between midnight and 5 a.m., depending on your jurisdiction. For the most part, Colorado follows this across the board. So unless they're coming home from work, or if they are accompanied by an adult, no driving between midnight and 5 a.m. And that's because that's when the highest number of crashes for young people tend to take place. It's not the only time, of course, but it tends to be a high fatality time for young people, mostly due to drowsy driving and some distracted driving. If you accumulate 6 points, and that is in regard to tickets in the first 12 months or 7 months before reach, or seven, sorry, 7 points before reaching the age of 18, you can lose your license. And of course, the driver is ultimately responsible for passengers in the vehicle. So if they're not wearing their seatbelts, teach our young people to tell them they're not going to drive until everybody's buckled. And young people, if your adult passengers are being stubborn about that, well, you can tell them the same thing. fines and penalties. Obviously, you can be fined or penalized for not wearing a seatbelt, for having too many passengers. Exceptions, of course, are medical emergencies or if you have family members in the car. No cell phone engagement whatsoever. No texting, no calls, no posts. No GPS. That means they need to find directions to where they're going before they go where they're going. Or have a passenger, an adult passenger, or depending on where they are in the GDL process, have their passenger be their navigator. Curfew, again, different depending on jurisdiction, but pretty much across the board in Colorado, midnight to 5 a.m. All of these, if you are pulled over and in your GDL phase, all of these have fines and points associated with them. Of course, community service can be an option. And depending on the situation or severity, you may have different options available to you. P.S. Parents, if your kids have to go to court, you get to go with them. And next, we're going to have Fabiola, SRO at Mitchell High School in Colorado Springs, and she is going to be telling us about the full privilege license. Thanks, Fab.
So the full privilege license, I'm not exactly quite sure, other than like once you have a full privilege license, after you have a restricted license for 1 year, you still must wear your seatbelt. You must always wear your seatbelt. And that's a primary law if you're under 18 and not everybody in the vehicle must be seatbelted. But after you are 1 year, you must wear your seatbelt at all times. Still no cell phone use while driving if you're under the age of 18. That means talking, texting, surfing, or any GPS use at all. Your parents can still place restrictions and they should do checkups on you all the time. They should come and ride with you and just kind of do like a secret shopper and kind of evaluate your driving. And part of that is it happens to all of us. We become complacent and we become comfortable thinking that we can let some things slide, but I'm going to encourage all parents to just say out of the blue, I am going to go and drive with you today. And just remember, driving is a privilege and not a right. The additional resources will still be like, you can always go to any driving school and look them up and ask them for references. Alive at 25, as early as age 15 years to 6 months is a great resource for you to go and gather information from. If you are still in school and you have a school resource officer at your school, we are great resources to kind of give you more information about anything that has to do with driver's education or other like community resources. We'll help you out in getting in touch with CDOT website, the Colorado Young Drivers Association. Drive Smart Colorado is one of my most favorite, and I'm totally loyal to them because they are so, so filled with resources. And they're just an untapped resource that I don't really think that people realize. You can always call your police department on non-emergency line and say, hey, I have a question. And they will always direct you to somebody who will either call you back and answer your question, or the call taker themselves can answer the question for you. As weird as this may sound, insurance agencies, that they should know all about traffic for all ages, and they should be able to give you an abundance of information. The last thing is the traffic stop itself. What happens if you do get stopped? Do not panic. We all at some point will be stopped for a traffic violation. And let me tell you, traffic violations can range anywhere from an actual traffic violation that means like you're either driving too fast or you ran a stop sign or something like that, or it can be an equipment failure on your vehicle and you may not know it. There is this magical book about all traffic infractions that not everybody reads from the beginning to end. And people are not aware of the traffic infraction until they have violated and they meet up with a police officer. What you should expect is when they pull you over, you're going to see little lights right behind you and they'll be red and blue. Those are emergency lights. That is the official lights that you should see behind you. Any other colors, do not stop for them. Call 911 and tell them something weird is going on. But you're going to see the lights. Preferably, we want you to pull over to the right-hand side. I know sometimes people freak out in the middle of traffic and may want to go to the left. If that happens, just do it safely, but always go to the right-hand side and pull off to the right-hand side. The officer will do their best to try to make sure that the traffic stops in a safe location. Once you pull over safely, just put your car in park and just wait patiently. Make sure you don't have your radio on And as we approach your car, we may touch the back of the car. We may kind of come up to it slowly. And that's just so we can see what's going on inside your car. We're going to ask you for your license, registration, and proof of insurance. You should always know where those three documents are when you are driving whatever vehicle you're driving. If it's your vehicle, it's your parents' vehicle, your best friend's vehicle, you need to know where the registration and proof of insurance is. And it is your responsibility of the driver to hand that over to the officer. The officer will always have to identify themselves, tell you which agency they work for, and the reason for contacting you. There should be no guessing. There's no games. We're gonna handle business, and we're gonna be very clear and direct. After they ask you for the information, they're going to go back to their car for a little bit. All they're doing is making sure that you're not some kind of wanted person with a warrant. You're not a runaway. There's nothing nefarious going on with you. Once we have established what we are going to do, sometimes we have discretion with a traffic stop, and sometimes we do not. If we have discretion, most of the time we will give you a warning, especially if it's your first time being pulled over. And if it's a traffic cop and they solely devote themselves to traffic stops, the chances of you getting a warning are like very slim. So I don't want to give you false hope with them. But most officers, we try to find out and turn it into an educational moment for the most part of it. All it is you are a juvenile. We will contact your parents and just let them know that we are out with you and that we stopped you for a traffic infraction. If we give you a warning, we're going to give you a business card with all our information and the reason for the warning and a call for service number. It should be quick. It should be easy. If you do get nervous, just take a deep breath and just remember, we're just really there to try to prevent any type of accident or anything bad happening in accidents. Out on traffic. And it's mostly prevention is why we conduct traffic stops.
Thanks, Fabiola. I would like to introduce Heidi McBroom, who is an insurance agent and is going to answer all of your insurance questions, hopefully here in the next few minutes. So Heidi, take it away.
Thank you very much. I've been doing these classes for about 6 years now, so things have changed a little bit, but for the most part, everything's about the same. So we'll go over some discounts and things like that and make sure that if you have any questions, raise your hand, throw it in the chat. I've got the chat open on another screen over here so I can see both of what's going on. So I'm ready to move forward. All right, so insurance is expensive. When you add a young driver to your policy, you can expect your rates to increase. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about discounts that can help bring those costs down, what kind of vehicles we recommend, the kind of coverage, and when to add your driver. Just so you guys know, I am a broker, so I represent about 40 different companies. So my experience is based on my client's experience, not necessarily exactly what your policy may be. So I would recommend you go back to your agent. And we do love to sit down with young drivers and educate them because this is something that they do not teach in school. So it's always super good to have a kid in my office where I can say, okay, this is this and this is that. And you know, we don't want to get points and we don't want to get tickets and what does it do to your insurance and those kind of things. So instructional classes, Master Drive is one of my favorite classes because they teach them all kinds of things to do. They teach them how to get out of skids. They teach them how to drive on ice. They teach them everything. As parents, we're not always the best teacher. I was not the right teacher for my daughter. She's 26 and she'll tell you that her stepdad taught her to drive because I was too scary. We would freak out behind the wheel. So I was not the right teacher for my kid. And so I didn't sign the affidavit. So I've got a 14-year-old coming up and her and I get along really well. And I've taught her a lot already about safety behind the wheel. We have a rule in our car, whether you guys want to implement it or not, but we don't have anybody with cell phones at all because our kids don't know how to get home anymore. And so I wanted my kids to learn from about the age of 10 forward that this is this street and this is that street and this is how we get home. And my girls were not allowed to even go to sleepovers until they knew how to get home from a party or from a friend's house. So just some things to think about. We're teaching them to drive and their faces are still in their phones. If we can get them to get their faces out of their phones now and start paying attention to what you're doing behind the wheel 100%, everybody's phones go in the glove box when we get in the car. It also allows us to have conversations. So just some suggestions. Alive at 25 is a great program. I love that you guys brought that up. It's also a program that is peers who have made bad choices a lot of the time that are in that class. They're court ordered there. And so no parents are allowed in that class. It's only kids under the age of 25. And so they get an opportunity to learn from other people that are their peer group, age group. So really like that program. I think it's $39 and I would highly recommend that. Some discounts that come from those classes are anywhere from 10 to 20%, depending on the company. And then this is like couponing, so you can stack all this, okay? So keep that in mind. Good grades is 3 to 5%, and we're not talking A-plus honor roll student. We're talking a B average or better. And you just have to prove that with a current transcript within the last 6 months. And then telematics, we all talk about, like you've heard of Progressive Snapshot. You've got DriveWise from... DriveWise is Allstate, I think. Right Track is, or that's Allstate, whatever. Everybody companies has one. Safety 360. A lot of them have gone to an app on the phone though. And so again, that's one of those things where we're telling them not to be distracted. So the app just needs to run. Phone needs to live in the glove box. It'll take track, keep track of how they start, stop, what time of day they're driving and how far. It's not a GPS, but it does know that there is no speed limit 80 miles an hour on any of our highways. So if they do get crazy, it's going to report that and ding them. But we've got a couple companies that are giving up to 50% off right now for those telematics based on driving habits. So that can be significant. So I highly encourage you to look into that telematics. Plus, it gives you a website that you can check in and see how your kid's driving. It'll tell you how many times did they stop too hard? How many times did they start too fast? And you can have a conversation about that. And that can go back to that parent teen driving contract. That parent teen driving contract will get you a discount with some companies, also another 3%. So I have a 26-year-old and we had a parent teen driving contract and literally she had a violation. I didn't have to get mad. I held up the contract and it was on the fridge. And I said, this was what you agreed to. And she just dropped the keys in my hand and went to her room. She knew there was no arguing. We had agreed to it up front. Didn't have to use it much, but it was there. No tickets or crashes. For young drivers gives you continually better rates moving forward. And being 16 to 16 and a half and getting their license versus 18 gets a better rate than an 18-year-old getting it for the first time. And the reason why is because there's no education required at 18. They walk in, they get their permit, they walk right back in and get their license. A 16-year-old had to carry a permit under somebody else's jurisdiction and teaching for a year. And they can carry it up to 3 years. So it's just better if they get their license after, but under the age of 18. And then being 25 years old, we'll get another discount if they don't get married before 25. But we don't encourage anybody to get married before 25 because your brain's not fully developed. So moving on. A lot of information here. So if you guys have any questions, raise your hand or throw something in the chat and I will do my best to answer over there. Your rates, you can expect your policy to double when you add a youthful driver to your policy. And that depends on the type of coverage that you're carrying and what vehicles you're driving. So if you drive newer cars, State Farm is one of the only companies that still writes an individual policy per car. And all the other companies that I represent, they all do household because they know parents let their kids drive the newer cars on a regular basis. And then those kids get into a situation in that newer car. And now there's damage on the newer car that costs more to replace, but the kid was rated on an older car that's not as expensive to insure. So State Farm is one of the only companies that still does it that way. The rest of us have moved to a household. And so if you're thinking about getting a new car right now, I would encourage you to do it now and get a car that's 2 to 4 years old so that when they start driving in 2 years, you now have a 4 to 6 year old car that they're driving, not a brand new car. A lot of parents get excited to get their new car and hand their old car to their new driver, and then they don't understand why the rates go through the roof. So just a little piece of advice there. You know, the lack of experience says that they're more likely to have a situation, and then the insurance is about $150 to $200 a month for liability only. But if they went and got it on their own, it's $400 to $500 a month. So I recommend that you keep your kids on your policy with you. As long as they're in the house with you, you can make them pay the bill. I don't have any issues with that. But we recommend that they stay on the policy with you for at least 3 to 5 years, they're getting your insurance experience rate, and that helps them. Also, most of our uninsured, 3 out of 4 of our uninsured drivers are under the age of 24 because they just can't afford it. So they're driving without insurance. So if we can just help our kids succeed in life, that is one of the easiest ways right there. Okay, so first, cars. We don't want something brand new. We don't want something that has too much technology that they don't learn how to drive. So if it's got lane departure and automatic stopping, and you know, then now your kid's depending on all this technology and they're not actually learning how to drive. We don't want this Jeep up here in the corner. I'm not against SUVs. I'm just against that Jeep right there because it rolls too easy and it's really hard to correct. So putting them in, like, you know, a Jeep Cherokee or something like that is not a negative. The Subaru Outback is a really good rate. Honda Civics get a really good rate. Anything with 4 doors, 4 cylinders, Toyota Camry gets a good rate. Ford Focus, Cruise. Be careful. You don't want anything that's got a, what do they call that? Turbo. We don't want anything with turbos in it. And the Chevy Cruze actually has turbos in it. It's a 4-cylinder turboed car. So just be aware of what you're buying and call your agent beforehand. Say, hey, we're looking at these cars. Throw a couple of VIN numbers at the agent. Let them run some rates for you. This is a page I like to spend a little bit of time on. A lot of people do not know what their limits are. I ask people on a daily basis, what are your limits of insurance? And they'll tell me I have a $500 deductible. That's not your limit. Your number one coverage-based thing that you need to protect is your liability, because everything that you hold near and dear, everything you've worked hard for, your house, everything like that, is now part of your liability exposure. And if somebody sues you, they can take you for everything that they have. And as long as that kid is on your policy, if there's an accident, they're coming back after you. And so people like to sue everybody for whatever reason, because that's our society nowadays. And the second they see a kid in a car, you know, your young driver's in, let's say, a 2014 Expedition or something like that, they see that and they're like, this kid hit me, came out of nowhere, I'm going to go after their parents. Well, your insurance only pays up to the number that you're insured to. So in this example, it's 100,000 per person, 300,000 per accident. So once that is exhausted, then you get to write a personal check for the difference. So that's why people need to understand. Our state minimums, which I have listed there, were established in 1968. They are 25,000 per person, 50,000 per accident, and 15,000 for property damage. Well, in 1968, that made sense because the average vehicle only cost $2,800. The average new home was under 15,000 and the average income was under 8. So those numbers made sense, but the average new home nowadays is 300 to half a million. And if you're carrying 15,000, you don't have enough coverage. So you would have to file against your own insurance. It's going to affect your rates for 5 years. And then your insurance company is going to try to go subrogate behind the scenes. But as soon as they find out they carry state minimums, your insurance company is not going to waste their time because they're not going to get anything other than that 15,000. So they're not even going to spend the lawyers to do it. So recommend there. You need to get to 250, 500 so you can get $1 million umbrella. And that $1 million umbrella will extend over the rest of your policies. It protects your house. It gives you legal representation. They're usually $200 to $600 a year, depending on credit score and history and all of that stuff. So I tell people it's the most affordable retainer for a lawyer and legal representation you can ever get. So take the time to ask your agent what your limits are. Ask for your declarations page. That first 3 pages of your policy is called a declarations page, and it'll show you all of those limits. And if you ever need somebody to look at those for you, I do it all day, every day for people, and I'd be happy to help. Okay. Make sure you have towing. If you don't have AAA, get it, because it covers your kid in any car they're in. So if they're out with a friend and the car breaks down, all they have to do is call AAA, give them their membership number, and they'll come tow that friend. So it's like $7 a month. It's very affordable. So get AAA towing. How to save on car insurance. I don't necessarily recommend shopping around your agent. I do recommend shopping around before you buy a car. I did mention that. You can take your deductible from $250 to $500 or $1,000. You can reduce optional coverages on older cars, put uninsured motorist property damage on an older car that maybe you're carrying liability only on. Keep good credit history, keep your insurance current, don't miss payments. You get a better rate when you have consistent ongoing insurance. Take advantage of low mileage discounts. If your kid's only driving 3 miles to school each way, make sure your agent knows that, because 3 miles versus 30 is a huge difference. The telematics, the good student discounts, the parent-teen driving contract, make sure they take a driving defensive driving course. As parents, if you're over 55, you can take a parent defensive driving course with AARP and you can save money too. And our cars have changed a lot since we all started driving. And I don't know if your senior centers around here offer it, but I went to one, and I'm not that old, but I went to what they call a in the driver's seat class. And it sat me in my car, showed me how to maneuver my mirror so I could get rid of my blind spots. It was a very good class. And I think that's something we haven't taught our kids very well, is how to position the mirror so that they can see out of that car as much as possible. Bundle with other insurance. If you're not a homeowner, but you're a renter, you can add renter's insurance. You get a discount for that. Adding the umbrella is another piece of insurance. You're going to get a discount for that. So definitely just ask your agent, how can I save money? When you add your driver is when they're licensed, not when they're permitted. And the reason is because they can carry that permit for up to 3 years. When to go on their own of insurance is 3 to 5 years. So I wouldn't recommend putting them on their own insurance until they're past 21. As long as they're in college, I would keep them on there as much as possible, just to give them a better start on their insurance. My daughter was 22 when she went on her own policy, and she had been on our policy since she was 16. And she was able to get a pretty good rate on her own at that point. And she had bought her first new car, and it was a perfect transition for her. So. Yeah, thanks for putting that in the chat. In the driver's seat and CarFit both have great tips on putting yourself in there. So these are some fun pictures that we took. That little cop car in the bottom is actually in front of my husband's shop. He actually built this for the city of Loveland for a corn roast parade. And so that was a fun little adventure. And we used to do career day at the elementary school, and we would take in race cars, and we would show the kids all of our safety gear and talk about all that kind of stuff. And so we got to build a lot of fun stuff like that. Talked about the four doors, four cars, teach your kids how to check tire pressure, teach them how to put fuel in the car. You don't know how many people I see at the gas station where kids are like, I don't know where to put this stuff. Phone in the glove box. I think we've all said that. Seatbelts have to be worn. That's a no-brainer. We should all know that by now. And then now it's time for questions and answers and surveys, and all of our contact information is going to be here at the end. If any of you have any questions that maybe we haven't hit, it's a ton of information. I am grateful to be here as a resource for you guys to answer any of the insurance piece. And that's basically it. Thanks for having us.
Thanks so much, Heidi and Michaela, Fabiola, and Grace. Thank you all for jumping in tonight. Zach, what do we bring to the permit appointment?
Yeah, and I'll go back to that slide here in just a second.
Sure. When I took my kids in, it was usually some kind of proof of address. So a water bill, or, you know, something official, some kind of official bill that you get from the state, birth certificate and social as well. Yes, thank you.
I have a quick question.
Yeah, Arif.
So about the insurance of the car. In the presentation, was it, Heidi, was it $300,000 until you have to pay the check in difference? I need some clarification on that part.
Sure, no problem. So you need to know your limits on your policy. So if you have a policy that's a 100, 300, they will only pay out up to 100,000 per person and 300 max. So learn your limits there, and then you would be able to answer that question fully. Because if you have a $25,000 policy, they're
because
only
I'm 15, and like say if I, because I have a permit, and like say if I would get into an accident, mm-hmm. you know, insurance would be able to cover only 100,000, correct?
Correct.
Okay.
So let's say that you're involved in a situation, and you're asking really great questions. You're involved in a situation. Mom and dad have $250,500 and they've got the umbrella. So the insurance, let's say somebody was hurt really bad and they have $500,000 in medical expenses. Your insurance policy would cover 250,000 of them. And then your umbrella would take care of the rest. And mom and dad wouldn't have to come up with anything more out of pocket.
Okay. And where could I is it still too early for me to apply for these insurance things at 15 or?
So you can't actually buy a policy at 15 because you're not of legal age to enter into a contract. You have to be on a parent's policy.
And how long could I be in that policy for? Up until what age?
As long as you're no longer a dependent. I have one gal that still lives at home and she's 40.
Oh, wow.
As long as you're under the same roof with them, you can be on that policy, or if they are still claiming you as a dependent, I recommend you stay on until you're about 22 to 25, or if you get married. Great questions.
So yeah, Arif, have your parents build the basement and you're set for life. Does anybody have any? Can teens use a separate GPS device? The answer, in the newer cars, Heidi, some of them have a GPS device into the car. Teens are not allowed to use their phones as a GPS.
Correct.
Period. So no GPS with their phones. They would have to write down their directions, or you would have to show them or teach them where it is they're going to be going, or go with them and, until they know where they're going.
If it's the GPS screens that are in the newer car, if they're caught manipulating that, it's just like a cell phone.
So
I will tell you, I got pulled over and I got a texting while driving ticket and I was not texting. I picked my phone up because it moved and the cop saw me and he slammed on his brakes, pulled me over, and I went to a Safe Kids meeting with a ticket in hand.
Darn it.
Yeah.
Sorry, honey.
It was not fun. So I'm just letting you know, you don't want to mess with anything. Just drive.
No touching. Just keep those hands on the wheel. I'm forward and go, 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 people.
Yep. And I will tell you, go ahead.
And may I say something really quick too about the whole texting thing?
Mm-hmm.
I know a lot of parents like for their young drivers to practice when they go on road trips because you get so much mileage in and hours in. However, you should also know that your contract is still valid, even if you're out of state, and texting laws in other states may be different from the state of Colorado. So just kind of be aware that, once you are the driver and you are the, even if you are the young driver, you are the one who's going to have accountability, and you're the one responsible, and your parent will go with you to court. Just FYI, more information, just about being aware.
Thanks, Ben.
Don had a great question. If Ben, you want to have a moment to answer, or what are good ways to accumulate hours as a teen new driver?
Can I make one suggestion?
Yeah.
This is Fabiola. So as a person who drives a lot because I'm on patrol, one of the best ways to get a lot of driving is get to know your city. Not only will you find out how to get from one location to another and how to figure out alternative routes if there's a traffic accident or there's construction or whatever, but it will help you pay attention to your driving and not be distracted looking for streets. So another great way to get driving time at night, and go with an adult. Everything looks different at night than it does during the day. I don't know why. Working a midnight shift is completely different than working a day shift. And so when you drive at night around your city, you see things differently. Get to know the navigation and get to know directions in town, especially because if mountains are west and the mountains are covered, you're going to have to try to figure out how to get around. And if you cannot use a GPS, which sometimes because our city is growing, your GPS will not have it won't be updated yet to let you know where you're going. It's just a great way to learn how to navigate without a GPS, without being panicked for time, and it'll help you focus on your driving rather than being distracted looking for streets.
Somebody's got their hand up.
Oh, that's me. Oh,
okay.
So I had a question too. You may have already covered this, but I'm 15 and I'll be 16 in 2 months, in November. How many hours, again, do I need for my driver's license? Isn't it like 50, like 9 hours?
Correct.
Okay. And
50, including 10 hours at night.
Okay. And I've done like 40 of those. So in November, could I be able to apply for my driver's license then?
Have you held your permit for a year?
I got it in like January, February-ish.
So you have to hold it for a year and then yes, you can apply.
Okay. And
and more is better. Get more hours.
Okay. And one more thing. How can I like spread, because I'm part of a national driving campaign and which is like 700,000 to 400,000. So like how could I necessarily like spread driving awareness through like, you know, the GDI laws and like, you know, the GUI laws, the, you know, other like different laws of driving. How could I spread the awareness of that in your opinion?
Try reaching out to the schools and see if you could go to the schools and do presentations for them. Maybe pair up with one of the school resource officers there or with one of the counselors or even some of the coaches and have them help you do some outreach and spreading your word.
Can also talk to some of the local driving schools.
And Aura, right. We have this great presentation that you just threw, and it would be great if you could be a moderator or an educator for your peers through your school. So,
and I could present like some of these slides in my presentation. Would that be okay with you guys?
Yeah. And we can make them, you know, you can take the information and make them fit for you too. So lots of great ways to engage with your peers. And I think it was Heidi just mentioned, mm-hmm. No, it was Fab. Well, everybody, coaches and, you know, going to your athletics. We have some great programs or campaigns that are geared with this information and other information, but that are geared to athletic coaches because oftentimes kids coming home from athletic events, either after practice or after a late night weekend event, they get into trouble. So coaches have an invested interest in making sure their players and their students get home safely.
Mm-hmm. Thank you all for joining us. And thank you to all of our presenters for your time and expertise. If you would like to present this information to your group, you may contact us to schedule a live or virtual event. And of course, you can always watch this presentation again. Safe travels.